and welcome our guests, our state level representatives. Before I get started with that, I know there's some public input.
I have a public comment, and this is Nancy Doctor. This is just a follow-up from last school meeting, and I appreciate Ms. Wilson's presentation on the behavioral health programs in the school. But my inquiry originally was to the board about whether or not you would kind of entertain the notion of partnering with community mental health agencies to advance and to expand our behavioral health in our schools. And if there are reasons why we're not going to do that, that really wasn't addressed in the last school department meeting. And again, you know, the reason why I'm bringing that up is because obviously there's an increased focus on all the behavioral health needs. In the April town meeting, one of the pieces of data that Dr. Doherty presented is that our reported incidences of depression with suicidality and substance abuse is higher than the state average. Now, the same week that he presented that, for people who don't read the American Journal of, or the New England Journal of Medicine, it was in the Globe, and it was actually talking about how there's a decrease in, or an improvement in teens' mental health. But the brunt of it was because there's an increase in access to services. And, you know, one of the things that we're all facing is fiscal constraints. And one of the things about partnering is that it's increasing behavioral health without putting a burden on our school budget. There's a really interesting study that the American Academy of Pediatrics put out. They surveyed their members, and close to 80% of pediatricians actually support school-based mental health services. The APA, the NSAW, all cite data that says that the compliance is increased when mental health is actually provided in schools for a very simple reason. Kids are very comfortable in school, so the compliances are better. I really have to applaud the school department for their work in gaining the grants for the mental health
first aid training.
But honestly, my concern is we ask our teachers to do an awful lot, and I'm concerned that we're actually placing an additional burden on them as opposed to actually looking at partnering and bringing in more mental health clinicians to do that. So I guess I'm going to again put it back onto the board. If there are really valid reasons that we're not going to partner, I would just like it actually put out for the public to actually discuss those public concerns.
One of the things that we're in the process of discussions now is with the Board of Selectmen on ways that we can combine services or utilize services. So, you know, maybe as an adjunct to that discussion, we can have a discussion with Erica McNamara and find out if there is, in fact, something we can do partnering-wise with the state or with other organizations.
If I can just add, because I think there's some confusion here. Mm-hmm. Carolyn, please correct me. Mm-hmm. We do partner right now. And we do not, it's not at the school department expense. We partner with Elliott Services when a student is in crisis. We do not provide crisis counseling, crisis services. Once it reaches a certain point, it goes to outside agencies. So we,
but that's what I'm talking about.
We partner now, and it's not out of the school department budget.
But I'm talking about in-house services, not out.
We don't have in-house.
No, I understand.
Crisis counseling services.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. You don't have them now.
Right, but we do partner with. That's what I'm we're saying.
But what I'm saying is the compliance and the actual treatment data is that actually studies show that when it's delivered in the school setting, there's actually improved. There is an improvement that's better than an outpatient clinic.
I'm sorry, I'm confused because we are partnering right now.
Give you an example. Beverly has in-house clinicians that actually do treatment in-house, meaning on school property. So your services are done in the school. That's school-based mental health.
But they're not school department employees.
They're not school, exactly.
Right. You're giving
them very separate. Yes, you are. Yes. Mm-hmm. That's what I mean about partnering with a community mental health agency, mm-hmm. in-house school-based services. Yes. And one of the things that, I mean, sure, you guys know this, you have an increase in special ed kids. I think the data is 1 out of 68 kids is diagnosed with autism, and 60% of those kids have a dual diagnosis, which means that they have a concurrent mental health diagnosis. So it's just looking at all of this and looking at what can we do in-house, because compliance and outcome is better when it's delivered in schools. That's all.
Thank you. Yes. Linda was first.
We'll duke it out.
W's are always last.
Yeah. Nancy, I really appreciate your consistently bringing this to our attention, and I think that there's a definite interest in supporting our kids through the mental health issues as well as the academic. That's why we brought in the behavioral health program and why the grant was gotten for ACASA. One of the challenges that we've discussed through the budget system and over when there have been wonderful ideas is that we also have a space issue at the school, and there are confidentiality issues. So it's, I'm not closing this down, and I think that we should talk further, but one of the realities we're grappling with is if we did bring clinicians here to do therapies with students, and I think that's what you're saying, as opposed to when they're in crisis, having their counselors come to the school so that it's part of their school day so that they'll follow through on their treatment. Am I understanding you? So the one of the challenges is that in many of our schools, the treatment, the physical therapy, the other treatments happen in the hallways because we've already designated their classrooms for other things, for classrooms. And please correct me if I'm wrong. So that's an additional challenge with that, even though someone else might be paying for the services. We're challenged by providing that private space that those kids need and deserve with their clinicians. So I'm not saying it can't happen, it's just another one of the considerations around bringing in the private to the schools.
Elaine.
So you referenced a couple times, Nancy, the compliance, improved compliance. I don't.
It means keeping appointments. If you look at data, the APA has put it out. That when you're totally dependent on outpatient agencies, like going to your doctor's appointment, there's actually poor compliance with treatment.
Right, so if you're in school because the kids are already here, then you're making the school responsible for compliance, and it's better.
It's not the school. Actually, it is improved compliance because you're delivering it actually at the school where both the kid and the families are comfortable. And more families actually utilize the services on school property after school for meetings.
So I guess I just, and this is probably going to be a little bit less popular, but I think we have to, I mean, we got to respect that we got our reps here and we only have a certain amount of time.
So I'm going to put it back on you.
Right, I just want to make a point that we are doing a tremendous amount. And I think we have to be cognizant of the fact that our primary goal is to deliver education. I understand, and Pat said this many, many times, students have to be healthy to learn and learn to be healthy. I get that. But I also think that we have priorities that we have to focus on, and we're very, very limited on the resources. We got a lot of great grants around mental health. We're doing a lot of great things. I'm just not sure that this is something we can, I don't feel like I have enough data or information or that we can put it on the plate. Certainly would like to talk a little bit more with Erica about it, but I just feel like we don't have enough time in the day to do the things we want with the kids.
That's
we got
exactly
kids on waiting lists for classes that we can't deliver.
No, I'm gonna leave it on the board to discuss it. I'm leaving it as a follow-up to what you presented. That's
all. Denying just
quickly. Yes. So I think it warrants further study, and I think it would be more under Carolyn's purview than Erica McNamara, just from my perspective.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah. It's definitely.
But definitely something I think to think about, and I'd like to know more about it personally, and I appreciate your insight.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Mr. Lewis, Mr. Dwyer, Mr. Jones.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a law firm.
I was like, just doing something good.
So there had been some requests to have our state legislators come and speak just about Some of the things that are going on right now, and I know there is a lot going on around, you know, putting the, hopefully the final touches on a FY16 budget. But there's also been some education discussions that have been going on at the State House as well. So this gives an opportunity for us to hear an update on those things.
Any questions, or you want us to?
You're gonna give up?
Jump right in.
I'll jump in. I think probably one that's of interest is Foundation Budget Review Commission.
Yeah.
They have, I think they've added a meeting that's, I think, next week. They think they extended their deadline out to November a little bit, and obviously there's a healthy dialogue going there, and obviously there's some probably some differences of opinion, some of which I think get based on urban versus suburban, and depending on the way you're situated, you may see the formula, and ultimately sometimes it gets back to, well, you want to tweak what you think will get you more money. I mean, that comes down to the bottom line. So we're waiting for the commission report and see what it says, and obviously that potentially on the basis for either legislative action or candidly potentially legal action for people that may want to go back to the court. So that would be one on the Foundation Budget Review. The budget, and obviously my colleagues will have, we're in the midst of conference committee discussions between the House and Senate. Obviously there are some significant differences in certain areas, although I would say less so. Based on the numbers, I think the Chapter 70 number is the same. The unrestricted general government is, the number is the same. There's a difference, I think, in the circuit breaker number. But you know, the difference is about this, and you can see some of these things sort of ending up in the middle, potentially. We have a little bit of a slow start to the committee process, so there's been a lot more hearings lately. Obviously, last week there was the big Park Common Core testing, high-stakes testing, and obviously the governor's initiated a sort of series of hearings throughout the state to look at what direction is best to Commonwealth to go. I would say those are probably some of the biggest ones.
It's also the issue of the moratorium on PAC and Common Core, so I'm going to support that, a moratorium on it. I think you need some kind of testing to guide, but what exact testing it's going to be, nobody knows at this point in time. So it'll be open for dialogue to understand and try to get some information back to what they feel as though is a better testing method. I mean,
can you talk about what the moratorium, just what that is?
Well, it's going to be a three-year, they're going to set it aside for 3 years. It's going to be a moratorium, and essentially what it is, they're going to do a review over that period of time to see if they can come up with something a little bit better than the PAC and also the Common Core.
I think it's House Bill 340, but essentially I think that's sort of the one that's gotten the most attention, maybe, because some of the groups are supporting it. There's a number of other pieces of legislation, but essentially it's a three-year moratorium, and then there's a commission put in place. I was talking to Superintendent before. There are different pieces, so maybe it's not a three-year moratorium, maybe it's a one-year, maybe it's a commission of running. But the idea is an openness to looking at the current paradigm and saying maybe it's, you know. I have a 9-year-old and a 13-year-old, and you know, the anxiety around testing and the volume around testing, can get to be excessive, and concerning. I don't know if I'm in the camp of saying we get rid of everything and you shouldn't do any. So I think how we proceed needs to be done, carefully. And I would say, just to give kudos to Jim, is obviously one of the other ones that I meant to mention was the unfunded mandate bill that we've tried. We got it to Ways and Means last year. And I know that's one that all of you have probably contacted anyone or all of us about at some point in time. But I'm hopeful that we'll have a little more consideration. I mean, I think candidly, some of the apprehension of moving forward is the fear of what we'll come back and say. Yeah. So, like good lawyers, you don't ask questions you don't know the answer to, and if you don't know the answer before you ask the question, don't ask the question. So I think that's the concern.
I mean, so, to me, unfunded mandates is a cut in your budget, local aid, back to your schools. Just the notion of unfunded mandate. It's a mandate, so it should come with some kind of funding. It doesn't make sense to me to send something back, because it is a cut in local aid, cut in Chapter 70 money. When you have to implement things, and there's so many things that you have to implement when it comes to unfunded mandates. I mean, it's a variety of different things. So essentially what it calls for, I filed it last session, and frankly, it went nowhere.
this year I'm hoping to get it out of committee with a favorable report, and at least to do the study on it, to take a look at it, and not sent to a study, because if it's sent to a study, it's gone. But hopefully to do a legitimate study on that, to come up with something. And if you're going to send something back, well, let's put a funding mechanism on it. Let's give the schools the abilities to know how to implement the mandates. You know, it's easy just to send mandates down and not have any explanation on how to impose them. I mean, it's very tough on school superintendents and principals in your building and guidance counselors when you really don't know what the intent of the mandate is. So this would clarify and tie up a lot of the loose ends, and I'm hoping to get it out of committee with a favorable response this session.
Go back.
Could I share? Maybe I'll just share a few comments also, and then just open up for questions. Does that make sense? Because there may be topics that we don't cover that you guys want to cover. So first thing I wanted to say was I wanted to thank you actually for inviting us to come in and spend a little time with the school committee. I really appreciate having that opportunity, and I hope this is a dialogue that we continue to have. I mean, obviously, many of us do talk informally, but having this opportunity we're all together, I think, is very valuable. In terms of the budget, I did want to point out that, I think you appreciate this, and you all understand how difficult and challenging budgeting is at the municipal level. Similarly, at the state level, this particular year, the state's facing about a $1.8 billion gap just to have a level services funded budget. So just to be able to continue providing all the services that we're providing in healthcare, transportation, homelessness prevention, housing, you name it, that's what the state's been looking at. So it is a challenging year that Governor Baker and the House and Senate have been facing. And I think given those circumstances, the fact that the major education accounts, Chapter 70, as mentioned by Representative Jones and Dwyer, that we funded that with a $100 million plus increase over last year. And that's actually even a bit more than what the governor put in his budget, as well as the unrestricted local aid account, which is obviously doesn't go directly to education, but it helps support other municipal services, taking some of the pressure off education. That's a 3.6% increase in that account. So those two together are $5.5 billion of the state budget. So that's the biggest piece of the state budget other than MassHealth, which is our obligated health care spending that we share with the federal government. So other than that, that's the biggest piece of the state budget. And that's right. That's where our priority, I think we all agree, it should be in terms of helping our public schools and our cities and towns. The special education circuit breaker in the Senate budget is fully funded, which is not always the case. So there's still a little bit of difference with the House. There's some other House accounts that are higher than the Senate, and that's often the way it is. And then they compromise in committee. We were also, no one mentioned, we successfully both in the House and Senate side added an amendment, an earmark specifically for Reading that I believe is $25,000 for some of the repair needs for the fields and athletic facilities given the harsh winter. Obviously, that's not a huge amount of money, but every bit helps. And given that same amount is in both the House and the Senate budget, we're pretty confident that should be in the final conference committee report. So that's, as long as the governor doesn't veto it, that should be good news. Also in the Senate budget, and there was some in the House budget as well, there was funding for the Safe and Supportive Schools Initiative, which is what we were just talking about a minute ago in terms of improving behavioral health and support, other social emotional supports for students. And I have to tell you that was something that I've been working on, and the Reading Public Schools and Superintendent Daugherty in particular are singled out as real leaders in the Commonwealth on this area of embracing this model of safe and supportive schools. I think that's really to your credit, and I just wanted to applaud you for that and the work you're doing. And I believe I'm coming back on Wednesday this week to meet with the superintendent and to kind of get a kind of closer opportunity to see the good work that you're doing here in the public schools around those areas of social emotional learning and behavioral health. The Foundation Budget Review Commission, I just wanted to add that although the final report I think will be delayed till later this year, I do believe they'll have an interim report probably later this month, and it appears that it will point to at least the two major areas that we all have been concerned about, which is health care costs and special education costs. And as we, and Linda and the superintendent, you were at the public hearing that we, that was on the North Shore, the same one that I attended. You know, if we were, if the Foundation Budget Commission did nothing else other than address those two areas, and I think they will do more than that, that alone would make a huge, and if the legislature and the governor followed through on those recommendations, there's a lot of work to do to get there, but that would make a huge impact on funding for K through 12, you know, in Massachusetts. And there's a further discussion as to how we would, you know, implement that, but that would be a very big step forward in that direction. So I think that's very important. Then the last thing I wanted to mention was that I don't know if all of you know that my other hat that I wear in the legislature, my first hat is representing Reading and the other communities of the 5th Middlesex, but my other hat is to chair the Public Health Committee for the state. And so that a lot of that work is around policies of health and wellness. And one of the main areas that I have been focused on, we are focused on in the committee, is substance abuse and tobacco. And I understand that Maureen Busby and Erica McNamara mm-hmm. came in, I think it was last week,
right.
and shared with you some of these horrifying statistics that we're seeing in our schools around what I would call new tobacco products. You know, so you know the story that cigarette smoking, that the good news is that is down among our young people. The bad news is that the industry is targeting young people with all kinds of new products, e-cigarettes, flavored cigars, smokeless tobacco. Many of these products are taxed at a much lower rate, so they're much cheaper, they're appealing to kids, they have attractive flavors and packaging, all the same kind of strategies that we used decades ago to make fun on cigarettes. So I want you to know that I really appreciate the work you're doing in Reading through the Board of Health and through your leadership and Erica's on changing, you know, for example, raising the age to 21 for purchase, other policies that you're pursuing at the local level. I'm hoping as a state we can learn from the experience that you're having in Reading and some of the other communities that are forward-looking on these issues, particularly tobacco across the state, and that we will look at ways to strengthen our tobacco law statewide so we don't have, you know, gaps in our policies. So, again, appreciate what you're doing there. I would love to get your feedback there. We may not have time for all of that tonight, but I wanted you to know that that's a priority for, on the public health side for our state. Obviously, substance abuse, opioids, mental health in general is a major area for all of us and the governor, but I wanted to specifically mention also these in the area of tobacco. So I'll stop there.
Yes.
So I have sort of a different topic, a little tangential it might seem. But it's related to basically if we get lots more students in Reading, we're already reaching some limits of capacity and our operational budget, you know, as you know, we had to cut over 800,000 this year. So there's some 40B developments on the table. And the densities are well above smart growth. So from a school's point of view, I guess I look at that. There's a lot of other aspects of the 40B that from just a community member or resident are a big concern to me personally. But from a school committee point of view, you know, anytime we've got densities far above, you know, what the smart growth is, we're gonna have pressures on the school district that I don't think we're, you know, well prepared for. And so I would urge you to continue the work with our selectmen, town manager, and I know there's been repeated attempts at some modification of the 40B legislation to put some zoning aspects in place that are really just smart and logical and are the right thing to do for our communities. I would assume maybe, I know North Reading had bigger footprint, had some room to maybe offer up, well, but Reading doesn't, and I'm sure a lot of Jim's other communities don't.
The 40B needs a lot more than just modifications.
Yeah, so, but
it needs a complete overhaul, right, on 40B.
So we obviously we're concerned. I'm concerned about what that impact is of these developments to the school system.
Look at the proposal that they're going to be having down at Prescott Street.
Yeah,
I mean, that's outrageous.
That's what I think, but
it's absolutely outrageous.
I just think it needs to be, there needs to be even apply the smart growth zoning. It shouldn't just be a free ticket. My goodness. There should be something. So we need your support on that, because that has a downstream impact on all of our municipal services and is definitely the schools. So.
Gary?
So I'm glad Jason brought up the issue of tobacco. And I don't know if Jason or Jim will remember this, but I'm sure Brad will, that we had a health protection grant many years ago that was a grassroots initiative that put a tax on tobacco products. And what it did was it allowed school districts to fund comprehensive health education. That money was taken away and is put into the general fund now. It was specifically earmarked for it, and we've seen major issues, not just with tobacco. And granted, tobacco use has gone down, but as you said, the ancillary aspects of tobacco has increased, not just, you know, chewing tobacco is a huge one as well. And I just like to, you know, see an initiative to go back, to take that money back. That was a grassroots initiative. I remember standing at Atlantic Food Mart, so collecting signatures, and it went forward. It got voted in by the people, and then it was just, the money was just taken away. It was definitely a difficult time financially, but nonetheless, it's, and I think that, you know, fallout is what we're seeing now with the opiate issues that are prevalent in our communities. And a lot of communities, there's a great article in the Lawrence Eagle Tribune, a three-week article on, happens to be the Andover Public Schools, relative to the heroin issues that are prevalent in their community. And, you know, if you thought about Andover, you wouldn't think necessarily that there were issues to that extent that there are. And I don't think it's all that much different in Reading, to be perfectly honest. I've had numerous students that have died with needles in their arms after they've gotten out of rehab or have never gotten to rehab, and it just gets worse. So we need some funding for that. I think that's really important. It's something that needs to be looked at. And just, you know, the behavioral health issues are one thing. Those are interventions. We need prevention. Prevention is what's going to make a difference. Thank you.
Probably not the time now, but I just wanted to go back to the, was it House Bill 340? That's the more, so how does that impact Reading now that we're in the midst of Park here?
We should probably say, we should talk about the bill. I think the chance that we're actually going to see that pass and have a moratorium is very small.
Okay.
So in this session?
Right now, right. So we could have a debate about whether we should or shouldn't.
Right.
And I think we probably have some different
views here.
Yeah,
I'm not interested in the debate.
But the reality is
right,
that
exactly.
That's, I don't see the legislature. I mean, you should say if you disagree.
No, that's what I'm saying.
I don't see that the legislature is going to step in and do that.
And so, you could see somebody saying, well, maybe it should be three, maybe it should be one, maybe it should be a 1 year, maybe they should be delayed. Mm-hmm. I mean, but the idea is that it was a piece of legislation that got a lot of attention. There was a very, very, and all the other bills around. I think, Linda, you were up last week, and I think it was a lot of attention around PARC, Common Core, MCAS, assessments, this and that. So I'm saying a lot more this year than probably in recent years.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's sort of a stay tuned, and obviously, you know, input is welcome.
Yeah. There's
obviously,
there's absolutely a growing and healthy conversation about testing and assessments and standards and all of that, which I think is overdue. I think we're saying the same thing. I don't believe that that's going to lead right now to the state abandoning Common Core or moving away from the transition to PARC, which is well underway. Could it lead to some tweaks to that? I think the administration, the new education secretary, Commissioner Chester, could do something. That's possible. I don't anticipate the legislature is going to step into this and take any major action right now.
Well, especially for funding for the implementation of PARC. Mm-hmm. I mean that's a major issue. A lot of people don't think about it. It's not one of these things to say, well, go ahead and do it. But the state should come up with some kind of funding to help implement and help alleviate some of the costs that's going to be to your budgets. So that's another direction that's going into, and obviously I think we all support that. Again, it all comes back to mandates and just a little bit of common sense that you can't just direct these things and automatically think that you're going to pick up the cost. It's crazy.
There's a lot of federal dollars at stake too.
Right.
So to Jim's point, in terms of how we pay for this in some schools that don't have the technology or that, we're relying a lot of federal money that was originally from Race to the Top.
Right.
So that's another reason that I think the state's going to be very hesitant about moving away too quickly or making major changes, is that could threaten our federal dollars.
Gary?
It is going to be cut back though, right? If I'm not mistaken, are we eliminating
next year? PARC, the consortium, has already said that it will go from two testing sessions to one
right.
testing session.
Mm-hmm.
And there'll be a decrease in student, an individual student testing by 90 minutes. But it is going to be one testing yeah. session instead of the two
Step
that
in
we
the right direction.
Currently have. However, if we go back to MCAS, it goes back to two testing sessions next year.
We'll make that decision. MCAS or PARC?
Which,
do you know who makes that decision? Is that
the
something?
PARC consortium is 12 states. MCAS is a state.
Right.
That's the DESE. Yeah.
But who would make that decision if we went back? You're talking about local
oh,
decision?
Oh, the board. No, the board of education.
Oh,
I mean,
could
if we
make
go
that.
PARC or MCAS, the board of education.
What, could state say we're not going to. Right.
State board of education. And there's no indication that, again, that others should speak up if they disagree, that's the direction they're heading to go back to MCAS. But there are questions, a lot of important questions being raised. It is a healthy discussion, I think, that we're having.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
So we haven't talked about this no. with the superintendent, so I just want to say that I think back to MCAS is the right verb in front of that, and I think that there are some real advantages I look at, important advantages in terms of being able to get the data so that it's usable data for teachers to make actionable with the PARC and that format of the test being online. I'd like to just see, so I think I feel a little better after you just sort of filled us in a little bit where it is in the dialogue, because we have to move forward always with every step. Stop and talk about it a little while, but make sure that we're moving forward, not backwards. And I definitely mm-hmm. agree with the back to MCAS Rouse. Perspective.
Thank you. This is just a really quick question since Mr. Nyan brought it up. We can expect to hear from the board November, December timeframe?
November-ish,
November.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll start the school year not knowing, which is...
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
I feel like the legislature.
The commissioner talked about the race to the top funds, and one of the concerns I have with the standardized testing, the high stakes testing, is the generic implementation across all the school systems and the conclusions that are drawn, whether they're valid or not. And one of my questions about the money, that the federal money that he's talking about us losing, is that all or nothing? Or like we've gotten, correct me if I'm wrong, there are certain school systems that have gotten waivers from certain parts.
No, states.
Certain
states get the waiver. Mm-hmm.
So is it possible that if a district or a state has other assessments in place, that the race to the top might honor those alternative assessments? We've been working on the DDMs, there's portfolios, there are other ways. We have professional learning communities all aimed at creating better, more valid, useful assessments in a time-conscious way. Would race to the top and the federal administrators honor that assessment is happening, accountability will be there, even if it's not
No.
a high-stakes test
well,
that is comparable
I would, to... I would say I don't think any one of us is in a position to speak
yeah.
on behalf of the federal government.
Right.
I would say that I would certainly like to think so,
mm-hmm.
That if we can show or demonstrate, you know, viable alternative techniques for assessment, that we should be given, you know, the latitude to do that without necessarily risking the money that they may say, well, if you do it this way, we'll give you money, but if you do it an equally valid
yeah.
alternative way, we won't give you the money. That you know,
yeah,
but
I mean, to build on what Brad said, for example, I don't know that the federal government per se cares whether it's PARC or MCAS.
No.
Right. That's
they
not
don't.
The issue.
No, they don't.
But if we were, for example, at what I was saying, where our funding could be at risk from the is if we did have, say, a moratorium for some number of years
right.
on continuing with standardized testing or requiring that for graduation or other ways that we
and
might.
I think that's
we,
why both
you know,
the secretary and the commissioner testified.
That is pulling back from race to the top is the way that we right. think the federal government would see that. So,
part of the problem right now is that the federal government is wrestling over the. Well, it's been 7 or 8 years now, the reauthorization of the Elementary Secondary Education Act. Until that gets reauthorized, we're going to be in this limbo because there are different versions of the bill right now that are going back and forth on how much control the states will have on the assessment versus federal government. So there's that wrestling that's going on right now, and until it gets reauthorized, states are going to continue to ask for waivers for the current bill, which was passed in 2001. Mm. So.
Yes.
I just wanted to say that being there Thursday was quite powerful because there were so many people invested in the discussion around these many bills that people put time into crafting, and that I didn't know what, I'm a real novice, so I didn't know what to expect when I went, but I actually was buoyed by the fact that the hallways were full and they had to change to a new room because it means there are lots of voices and lots of opinions in the discussion, and I think that's healthy. I think I was surprised by some of the testimony. It wasn't quite what I would have said, but I valued that it was said and the way it was said because passions were high on both sides. And so the dialogue can only take us, I think, to a better place. And so I was really glad they moved it to Gardner. I was sorry that I was in the hallway while Commissioner Chester talked. But I think that the discussion is now happening, and I'm glad that you're all very invested in the discussion as well. I'm very grateful for that. Thank you.
Yeah, for those who may not know, what I think what Linda's referring to is the Education Committee had a public hearing on Thursday, specifically on bills dealing with assessments and testing. There will be other Education Committee hearings through as we continue through the session on charter schools and funding and all kinds of other, in many cases, equally challenging issues. And you're always welcome to attend in person, or if you have
testimony,
share it with us.
Send it to us, we'll submit it to the committee.
We can submit that on your behalf. And I do sit on the Education Committee, and you know that having that feedback directly from school committee members is very valuable. So,
can I add something? Sure. We did have someone come to ask our school committee about confidentiality issues around the fingerprinting new mandate. And so just a heads up that that is something people can make their voices heard if they send it to you, if they send their testimony to you about their experience with the confidentiality issues, their concern about student data, that is something that was one of these, I'm not gonna see it really quickly, but that was one of these acts, the so, bills, yes. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Second from the top.
Yeah.
Oh,
social media.
Oh, okay. On
actually, there's a couple there.
The House 360 bill. So an act relative to student online information protection policies. And then Senate 298 is an act protecting student privacy. And then House 495 is an act relative to student data. And 474 House is an act relative to student data privacy. So it's really on the radar that we need to protect our students' information. And I think that's good for everyone to know that it's not just here. It's the state is talking about this and that they can write to you with their experiences.
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah.
So just to build on those, so that, if I'm not mistaken, all of that didn't come with any funding in terms of mandates and executing that. So I think, you know, it's, you know, whether you talk about bullying or collecting CORI information or fingerprint information, right, all of that requires time for our staff. And
The bullying was a perfect example. When they came in with that last session, they demanded that every school district have a bullying program.
Right.
And I can only speak for Woburn; they were a little bit ahead of the curve and a little bit proactive. So they had done a lot of things before that came out, but it caught a lot of school districts by surprise.
Right. Well,
so what do you need? You need another psychologist to come in, or another health and wellness teacher or something to that effect to come up with a policy. You're absolutely correct.
So and Reading has had that policy, so I think we were ahead of the curve on
this
as well. But I just, again, have to be really cognizant, and I know that you and I were at I thought it was the Safe Schools that you talked about, presentation a couple months ago on sort of health and wellness. And the group has great, it's great programs. It's all really good, important stuff. But you have to recognize that, you know, at a minimum, it puts time on a staff where, you know, we have in this office on 2% or less. And that means that, you know, means that there's other data that might be equally or more important that we might not be able to get to analyze. So I think it's just really, really important as these are coming up that that funding, how is the district going to fund that, has to be part of that discussion. If we're going to take it apart, you know, if we're going to undo it, how do we undo it? If we're going to do something, it takes time and money and labor and a person to do that, and especially protect the privacy, like to have the right processes in place so that when a parent is given a Social Security or, you know, providing that form, there has to be a process. It doesn't just materialize. So I appreciate continued effort on that.
And I think given how tight funding is and how many school districts, almost every single one, is struggling just to provide the services and the education and the supports that are already needed, I think we're sitting here and our colleagues, I think all of them are very sensitive to that. The reality is there's how many bills listed there. There's, I don't know the exact number, but there may be 300 bills before the education committee. You know, 98% of them aren't going to go anywhere. Not only for this reason, you know, there may be bad policy, but one of the main reasons is because there is a concern about maybe that is a good thing to do, but we don't have the our schools don't have the funding to implement that, you know, right now. So I can tell you when we have those debates over bills, that's, you know, always one of the considerations.
Yeah. I mean, the fact of the matter is most legislation in Beacon Hill isn't going to get passed. Mm-hmm. I mean,
And close to 10,000 bills were filed this session.
Yes.
10,000.
Wow.
Sometimes people see that there's a debate on it. That's why I mentioned about the moratorium. That just because there's debate on it doesn't mean it's going to pass.
Usually the way the media reports it is up for consideration on Beacon Hill today is so people call and say vote against
they
it.
Think
and
it's
we find
pass.
Out it's actually only a hearing.
Yeah.
Which is very different than taking a vote on it.
Right.
So. And it's extremely frustrating when you're passionate about a piece of legislation that you file. And it has a lot of common sense to it. And it goes absolutely nowhere. So when you hear the term that your bill has been sent to study, that is the proverbial graveyard. Okay. Let's not mince words about it. Very seldom does a study come out of where it's supposed to be for a study. Right, Brad?
I don't mean many a time.
It's as you know, the process is designed to be very
methodical
and make it very difficult.
He was going to say deliberative, but he knew that.
No, I know. No, exactly.
I pull us there, so you could jump right in.
Meandering is more the appropriate word to be used.
It's meant to not be easy to, you know, and that can be very frustrating.
But
when
it should be easy.
There's something that we think is, you know, common sense or no, right? You know. But then on the other hand, they're also you don't want to have unintended consequences and a lot of these policies are not simple things. They do need a lot of thought and care.
Yes.
I just wanted to flag something that I anticipate coming down the pipeline, and so did parents that I spoke with at Friends and Family Day this weekend, is the full and half-day kindergarten, and I'm so grateful that you've been working for the funding of mandated programs. But down the road, we now have 70% of our families that want full-day kindergarten, and they're willing to pay tuition for it. But down the road, if the state decides that full-day kindergarten is the only right way to go and then tells us that we need to do full-day kindergarten, we have 30% that have not chosen full-day kindergarten, and it's a tuition-based program, and we're mandated to provide kindergarten. So if that happens, I would anticipate we're going to be in a financial bind, because to then provide free kindergarten that's full-day, something that we're used to getting tuition for a revolving account that helps pay for the staff and the full day. And then we have 30% that, and it might not be that in the future, but if it were, that weren't planning on full day, and we can't charge for it because the state says we need to offer it for everyone. That's going to be a huge expense for our town and our schools.
Well, the good news is that discussion is well on its way. That is a major topic.
That there'll be money with it?
That is a subject that they've been talking about now.
The other sentence. Every other sentence has to be the money with it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
But I think some of the talk is even jumping beyond full day K to pre-K.
Preschool.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it sends a red flag, not getting into the merits of doing it, but just from the financial, the space constraints, and saying, okay, you know, you come in, you work with MSBA on doing a population, and are you building adequate space? And then say, okay, by the way, instead of having, you know, back in the day, you know, two sessions of kindergarten, morning and afternoon, and then say, okay, now it's doubled because it's now it's full day K, now it's pre-K. And some may have pre-K that's almost universally tuition-based now, at least. So we need to be cognizant of that because they're a huge facility for getting the merits of it. And
well,
I think sometimes the frustrating thing is I kind of sometimes fall in the camp about when we get K through 12 right, then let's talk about maybe the next thing. And I still think, and that's a difficult question, but the space constraints and the costs are just really, really large.
Thank you.
Are they waiting to come and see you?
Yeah. The angry man is here for us.
There's a lot of passion out there.
Just like a Frankenstein movie.
As always.
With the torches and the...
We know how busy you folks are, and we really appreciate you taking the time to come out.
Pleasure.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you for all your representation.
Good luck.
Yeah. Oh, it's a recognition night.
Yeah, we're recognizing
people. Oh, there we go.
It's a good
day.
It's a happy mom. It's a happy mom.
Must have been something Jim said. I don't know.
God, I could talk about that for hours.
Thanks, Representative.
We go out there, right? Are they coming in here?
So you get a short reception.
Yeah. Is it out there?
Or?
It's out here.
Yeah. Right. Should we adjourn?
Oh,
we
so
need to adjourn?
No.
We don't need to recess.
We can just leave the camera and
recess. You're taking a recess.
Oh.
Yeah.
Take a 5-minute recess.
More than five.
Call the meeting back to order welcome, you know, one of our favorite events, I guess, the staff recognition. And I apologize for starting late. We got into some discussions with our state reps, and they never end quickly anyway. So, Dr. Dard.
Yes, thank you. As Mr. Robinson said, this is one of our favorite events of the year because we get to recognize our staff that have reached various milestones in their career. We have tonight here teachers that are reaching professional teaching status. We have teachers that have reached the 10-year, staff that have reached the 10-year milestone, staff that have reached the 20-year milestone, staff that have reached the 30-year milestone, and we are also honoring tonight those staff that are retiring from the Reading Public Schools. Michaela Saunders, who's right here, our Human Resource Administrator, has been putting all of these items together, and she's gonna just show you what each milestone is gonna be receiving tonight.
For our retirements, we have these crystal apples, and they're inscribed with the person's name, how many years of service they have, and a thank you for all of their years of service with us. For people who are reaching the 10, 20, 30, or 35-year milestone, we have pins with their years of service. And for teachers who are reaching professional teacher status, we have award certificates congratulating them.
So we're going to start first with our food service department and our director of food services, Kristen Morello.
Hi, everybody. We just wanted to thank you for the opportunity, and I would like to present Dolores Souther, who works at Reading Memorial High School, with her 10-year pin.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And I'd also like to thank Roberta Ferrari, who works over at Joshua Eaton, also for her 10 years of service.
Thank you.
We also, two people who aren't here, Maria Marais from Wood End School, as well, had 10 years of service, and Connie Kirchian, who works at the high school, had 20 years of service but couldn't make it tonight. And
really warms my heart to see Maureen Zia here. This is Tommy Zia's mom. And Maureen has been with us for 30 years. We just want to thank you.
Okay. Karen Feeney from the Joshua Eaton Elementary School is going to recognize her staff.
I need room. Okay. So it's so nice to honor all of the staff that we have. I'm going to sit. We have two teachers who have reached professional status that aren't here tonight. Nicole Brett, who is our school psychologist, and Jessica Cornetta, who is a first grade teacher here. So I'll be happy to present these to them tomorrow when I see them at school. But for the staff that is here, it is an honor to recognize Linda Lidecker for her 10 years of service and for retirement. So she gets a double. And we have Sarah Rizek, who is celebrating her 10 years of service. Now I'm just going to stand. Tina Torman is also receiving her 10 years. So congratulations. And we have Bill Lewis, who is receiving his 10 year and his retirement.
Oh, wow. 20. How many is that? He's 20 years.
So there we go. So thank you very much.
And Kathy Giles, principal at Killam, will recognize her staff.
Absolutely. Hello, everyone. Thank you for this special night. Okay, so we have three Killam staff that have been working for 10 years here in the district, and we have three that have been working for 20. So first, let me have up, if we'd be able to sneak out, Katie. Katie Cole, come on up. 10 years. And then we have Tanya McGuire, 10 years of service here. Thank you. Ann Sweeney is next. Thank you. Just kidding. Denise Sciozzo, come on up. 20 years of service here. And Catherine Rice, thank you, Catherine. Catherine's also the assistant principal at Killam, so thank you so much. And Donna Mullen, who is not only celebrating 20 years here, but she will be retiring at the end of the school year. We're trying to keep her in as a substitute teacher for years to come.
Already, but I just said, like, yeah, my boys are 21. Those twins are 21.
Right? And she doesn't age.
Well, totally. She looks exactly the same.
Should we?
Are you also? Great. Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, the way we're going to do this, we're going to go that way.
That way out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Congratulations, everyone.
No. No.
Just do it.
Thanks for having
me.
Congratulations.
Oh my gosh.
Thank you.
Okay, doing great. All good. Of them.
Good. All of them.
Yeah.
Okay, Bertram.
This differently next year, though. This will be like in the
something about the elementary
Barrows
yeah.
And Rise around
a lot of time.
Go ahead. Yes, we're in. Go ahead.
You know what I'm saying? I don't think that's a bad.
Yep, come on in, sit down.
But
just a short transition here. Who do you have for us there? Okay, we will have Wood End Principal Joanne King present her recognitions.
Perfect. I didn't get to see anybody model this for me before, so.
They did a great job.
A little unfair.
So we're really honored tonight to recognize some amazing people who are here behind me. I think I'm in a bad position here. So I will have you come up. And we'll start with those who have 10 years of service. So Christina Erb. Fabulous art teacher. Thank you, ma'am. I hope they all say 10. I can't turn my
That's
glasses
10,
on.
Yes.
I might say
Thank
30.
You. I'll take it.
Thanks, Sean, your help. Oh, that's better. I look like you too. No, I'm just kidding. next we have so Lisa Sulia. Actually, I'll just go down the line. 10 years. School nurse. And Stephanie Malone, 5th grade teacher. She started when she was a toddler.
Yes.
And we have Marion Nyan, who teaches 3rd grade. There you go, ma'am.
I can't read it either.
You need to put your glasses back on.
This one's 35.
That is not for you. I told you I needed them. So we have, I'm good, Barb. So then we, come on up, Barb. No, come up here. Barb, come up to get your glasses. So Barbara Sheehan is our most extraordinary staff member who is being recognized for over 35 years of service. So.
Actually, thank you very
she
much.
She definitely started as a toddler. And then I'd like to recognize two staff who will be receiving professional teaching status, and that would be, the first person would be Linda Michelle, amazing special ed teacher. And Jacqueline Parker, also a special ed teacher. I think I got all of the Wood End staff, so I'll take the rest of these pins for the remaining who were not able to make it this evening, but thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to recognize these educators who are truly spectacular.
Eric Sprung, Principal of Archibald.
I am happy to honor the staff at Birch Meadow. We have a teacher that is receiving professional teaching status, Alicia Wells, our DLC teacher. Congratulations. And we have some teachers that are here for 10 years of service to Reading Public Schools. Kathy Gary, one of our tutors. We have Danielle Piazza, 1st grade teacher. And Jennifer Scribner, 4th grade teacher. And for 20 years of service, as well as 40 years of marriage today, this is Donna Clunan.
Congratulations, everyone.
And I actually have one more. This is what happens when I don't wear my glasses.
So Mary Sage has also to be recognized for 10 years of service. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
We're going to have Rise and Barrows next.
Congratulations, everyone.
Thank you.
Your anniversary, too, Donna.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Can I have rides and barrels?
I'm sorry.
Michelle, she's got your stuff.
Okay.
Michelle has her stuff.
Michelle has my stuff?
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, I need glasses?
Yeah.
I don't have my glasses.
No, I'm good. I'm going to ad lib. Thank you.
I know. That's nice. Thank you.
Where's Matt, Cheryl?
No, I'm good, really. Thank you. I don't really have anything written down. I was just hoping that I could read this. I got it.
We'll begin with the Rise Preschool.
Great.
Debbie Butts.
Good evening. Thanks for inviting us. This is a really exciting time. We are recognizing Roberta Crosby for 20 years in the Reading Public Schools. She has been an unbelievable support of me since I came 2 years ago. She's filled with information, enthusiasm. She was in the military, so she really knows what to do in the classroom. Kids love her, and we're so appreciative, and thank you so much.
Thank you.
Erica Boren is not here tonight. She regretted not being able to come. I guess you're having move-up day or parents' night at Coolidge.
Yes.
And she's got a child that's moving into Coolidge, so she couldn't be here tonight. But she is being awarded with professional teaching status tonight and deserves it. She's an awesome teacher. She is a great team member, and we love her.
Heather Leonard, principal of Paris.
Good evening, everybody. Nice to see you all. Come on up, please. I do have a few Barrow staff that I'm going to recognize this evening. Our 10-year seasoned professionals are not with us this evening, but achieving their 10 years of service with the Reading Public Schools is Sarah Atwood, our PE teacher, Virginia Gath, who's one of our paraeducators, John Larracy, a fourth grade classroom teacher, and Michael Donahue, who's our Barrow's computer technician, and they are fabulous members of our Barrow's team. So we celebrate them, even though they may not be here with us this evening. I'd like to start by recognizing Jacqueline Guerin as well. So Jacqueline actually achieved professional status last year, and because of she's been here in a few different roles as a paraeducator and then stepping into the classroom, and so we didn't get a chance to celebrate her last year, so she's a good sport and came this year. So she's PTS plus one, but Jacqueline's one of our fabulous third grade teachers, and we adore her, and she's doing an excellent job, so congratulations, Jacqueline.
Thank you.
And if I could not give this, which would keep her with me, I would, but unfortunately, I don't think that's an option, so Sue Vegas, who's our Special Education Learning Center teacher, is retiring this year. Sue is an absolute cornerstone at Barrows. She does so much for every student that she comes into play with, whether it's students she's working directly with, kiddos in the classroom, or just the friendly smile in the hallway. And additionally, I think she is absolutely the go-to staff members for so many of us that need a quick word of advice, a great laugh, or just, you know, somebody to bounce some ideas off of. So she is there before almost anybody and stays there later than anybody else still, and we will absolutely miss her. So congratulations on her retirement to Sue. Thank you for letting us celebrate these professionals. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to bring in Coolidge next.
Anybody else all right?
You know?
Mrs. Marchant is actually at the fifth grade parent information night at Coolidge, so Mrs. Pink is going to be filling in for her this evening.
Okay, ready?
Yes.
I am honored to be here tonight to recognize Coolidge staff. I'm going to start with Denise Conry, a very hardworking teacher who goes above and beyond every day at Coolidge. And Denise is being awarded her professional status. So yay. Congratulations. Thank you, Denise. And also here is Connie DiBenedetto, who is being awarded tenure status. Woo-hoo. How many is 10? And Connie is also a very dedicated, hardworking teacher. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, I have several teachers who are not here tonight, so I'd just like to recognize them. Earning professional status as well, Samantha Prindeville, Laura Vance, earning 10-year status, Amy Kasperzak, Sarah Marchant, who's doing the Move Up Day presentation with incoming sixth grade teachers, Craig Murphy, and that's it. And we have retiring, and I wish he were here, Mr. John McCarthy, after many years of service to Coolidge, and we will be sad to see him go, and I will personally deliver this to him. Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Parker Middle School.
Shayla has your stuff.
Hi. Good evening.
Tell me what you want to say. Good evening. Thank you for having us. We appreciate it. We know you must see a lot of candidates here tonight. Hi, Alex. How are you? It's good to see you. We have 8 people here with us tonight. We have 16 overall that we wanted to honor this evening, but 8 were able to make it. We have 4 teachers that we are awarding professional teacher status to, and we're very pleased to do that. It seems like a moment ago they were hired here, and I couldn't be more pleased to offer them professional status. And the first teacher is Andrea Bear. The next teacher is Sarah Gilbert. Next teacher is Megan Kaiser. And last for professional teacher status, Julianne Matrano. So the next 3 teachers I'll be introducing have 10 years of service, and it is a pleasure to have them here this evening. Again, I hired them as well, or I was part of the team that hired them, and it seems like a moment ago that they have started here. We were just reminiscing about the hiring process when we were waiting outside. The first teacher is 8th grade English teacher, Steve Olivo. The next is 8th grade social studies teacher, Elizabeth Shanley. The next teacher is 6th grade science teacher, Constance Quackenbush. So, and the other teacher that we'll be honoring this evening has 20 years of service. I know she gets 2 pins. And so it's been really wonderful working with her. And that is Amy Ropel, art teacher. So thank you very much. I will be sure to kind of pass the rest of these along to the rest of the candidates. Do you want me to announce their names?
Sure, if you'd like. Yeah.
Okay. So the other candidates that couldn't be here this evening, for 10 years of service, Jean Duran and Laura Fox. For 20 years of service, Carla Ricci. And for 30 years of service, who's had a remarkably distinguished career, school psychologist Diane Ketlack. Yeah. So, please. So the other teachers that were to be honored tonight are, we have four teachers that are retiring. That is sixth grade English teacher, Susan Kalmakis. Jill Panadosi, who's our reading specialist, as well as Jerry Gomes and Diane Ketlack will also be retiring. So we thank you for having us this evening. We really appreciate it. And I'll be sure to pass these along as well as your congratulations. So thank you.
Thank you.
All the pens.
I think we're good. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thanks, Doug.
Doing everyone?
Good.
Adam, how about you?
Good. Excellent day. All right. Good evening, members of the school committee. It's my great pleasure. I guess we'll begin with our Years of Service Award, if we can. I'd like to first honor Ms. Heather Connor, who's been with us now for 10 years. Congratulations, Heather. That's right. And next, I'd like to honor Ms. Kathy Crowley. Is Kathy, no? Well, let's see, who else is it? Miss Mary Ann Lynn, who has been with us for 20 years. Congratulations. So now we'll shift gears to our folks who have just earned PTS, who are very proud now to be with us for completing their third year. First, I'd like to honor Miss Kelly Bedingfield. And next, I'd like to honor Ms. Natalie Cuna. Congratulations.
I'll take two.
Who else? And moving on now to our, sad to say, our retiring staff. As much as I've tried to talk them out of that, first, I'd like to start with Dr. Alex Valentine. Next, I'd like to honor Mr. Jeffrey Nelson. And next, I'd like to honor Mrs. Carol Galvin. And next, Ms. Paula Von Yu. Mr. Scarpito could not join us. He's upstairs doing Future Freshman Night 2. And then Heather, I got you. That's everybody, right?
I think you got everyone.
I think I got everybody.
Thanks very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Sunday, and the girls softball team, they're phenomenal. It was so entertaining to watch. They are just, the way that they work together, it was a professional softball team. So the game is tomorrow night at 7 o'clock in Lowell. We're playing Norton, and we'll be there. Yeah, very exciting to watch them.
Thank you. Mrs. Webb,
you.
I just wanted to say myself and other members of the school committee, as well as Dr. Daugherty and Martha Seibert, were at the Friends and Family Day, and it was really well attended. It was, I think, great weather. It was we appreciate Martha got the boards that we could have for parents, and we actually, I think, had a lot of traffic, lots of families with young kindergartners or kids that weren't even in kindergarten, lots of strollers, lots of questions about, you know, what we have for the facilities, how long they were going to be there, what's the long-term plan. So it was a good discussion, I think, very positive. I'm pretty sure most of the questions were really around the kindergarten and early childhood. And I thought it was a great day. And I don't know, Mrs. Doxer was there, and Jill was there. So maybe you want to add a little bit.
Thank you. Yes.
It was nice also seeing some of the other booths that were there, representative of school groups, like the Robockets were there. And there were, the Interact Club was there. I didn't see all of them. And Rakasa was there. There might have been others that I didn't get to because it was so busy there, but it was really wonderful. We have a new family that moved into Reading, and they were really wowed by the community spirit. It was nice to see that.
Did you have a report?
I do have a report. I actually, so I had the pleasure of attending last week the Joshua Eaton Publishing Day. And I actually took the time to write something down this time so that I'd make sure I covered it all. It was a spectacular day. It was the third time this annual publishing event has happened, thanks to the efforts of parent volunteers and teachers, headed by Andrea Nelson and Maura Adams. I heard that there were over 80 parents that participated in this event. The event highlights children's writing, and each student publishes a book complete with illustrations and a binding. Many including glossaries and table of contents. For the nonfiction, the children did all of the research. And for the fiction, students wrote about the topics meaningful to them and their peers. Each group was composed of one student from each grade, along with one or two adults. Each child read the story to the group and received positive feedback from the others in the group. This was a real phenomenon, watching the students and their posture as they read their story. I, as a writer, know that it's sort of intimidating, scary to read your work to other people. But as they read their stories and as they saw the attention they were given by the others in the class, you could physically see their posture change and the pride that they were feeling as they got this attention. And that increased when you saw when the others in their group gave them their feedback. And the feedback was really impressive. It was very specific. It wasn't, oh, just a good job. It was specifics. One of the fourth graders complimented, I think he's a third grader, but I might get shot for that. It's either a second or a third grader, on his use of onomatopoeia in his book, and he didn't know what that was, and so he asked. And the fourth grader patiently explained to him that onomatopoeia is when you use a word to represent a sound in your writing, like buzz or like bang. And he looked, his eyes lit up, he said, like chop, I use chop. And then, so then he repeated what it was that he had learned back to her, and then they went on to other comments as well. But it was really nice to see not only what was the process of that day, but what had been learned before, bringing their past lessons, their writing lessons to bear when they were giving feedback. So I just went ahead of my writing. So this same fourth grader, I just wanted to give this little anecdote. The same fourth grader shared a fiction story called Keeping Calm and Following Your Dreams, which she said she prepared after thinking about her own feelings, as well as thinking about many of the books that she had read. It was a very deliberate process, and she knew each step of the way. She said, though, she was very careful not to plagiarize. Her story embedded, it was about her love of the trumpet, and or her character's love of the trumpet, and her dream of becoming a proficient player. And it embedded how difficult it is to learn an instrument, how powerful peer pressure and criticism is, an insider's view of sibling rivalry, the positive and negative influence of friendship at that age. And it was intriguing to hear her view of what it would be like for a student trying something that, working very hard at something she dreamed of excelling at. So it was really a healthy reminder for the chaperones, for the facilitators who are adults, parents, and teachers, to hear from their point of view also what was important to the children. And I was also asked, someone apologized to me because it was sort of organized chaos at the beginning, because every child came out with a name tag with a group written on it, and they were mixed up, so they weren't with their classmates. It was grades K through 5 in each group, so they were with all new people. And they'd come to the door, and then they were directed over to where their group was. And I actually even felt the merit of that. These kids conquered this little confusing, chaotic feeling time because it was organized. And they, when they reached their group, they'd already succeeded in something that was challenging, but definitely planned out carefully by the school. So one of the organizers, Andrea Nelson, reflected that it was really wonderful to collaborate with the teachers and parents, which is what made the event such a success. And then en route to my car, 4 or 5 other parents stopped me and talked to me about what a great process it was. So I just wanted to shout out to Joshua Eaton for that event, and I was very glad to be able to attend.
Thank you.
In a very short second one?
Sure.
So today I went to the North Shore Pride Learn and Lunch in Beverly, where they were reaching out to educate and empower people to respect and empower trans and gay and lesbian. I always, those four letters. Thank you. Yes. This was just one of the people. But I was very proud to be able to tell them about what Reading had done for the robes at graduation and what a collaborative process it was when it was realized that our roles separated by gender at a time when gender was not so simply separated, and that the respect that was manifest in the process in giving students a voice and ownership of the decision, and how wonderful it looked with students choosing the color of their robe, not according necessarily to their gender, but according to the color that they wanted with the scarves. And I was very proud to be able to say that Reading is at the cutting edge of that, and it's so important. And also that Harvey Milk will be looking down in the library and being an inspiration for that same kind of respect. So, thank you.
Thank you. Any other reports?
Sorry,
Carol?
I just wanted to give an update on the program review by Walker. We received the draft, which is not a public version as of this point. They want us to review for any factual inaccuracies, so I will be going through the document to make sure there aren't any inaccuracies in the document, and hopefully by the end of the month we'll have the document and then prepare to present that out to you.
Thank you.
And we had an email from a parent that was interested in wanting to know if it was going to be a public document, mm-hmm. which I didn't feel comfortable. I know it is, but I'm assuming Chuck will respond to her. But
yeah, we'll present it out.
Yeah, we just did.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just saying.
To report out at this meeting. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep. So is this something that's going to be presented to the committee or given to the committee when it's all
done? It will be presented to the committee, yes.
Okay, okay.
It's in the draft stage right now.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
So I this Saturday was at Friends and Family Day with Elaine and Linda and Julie. So it was a well-attended event. So the boards that were presented are there for your viewing pleasure this evening. They will go with the principals tomorrow back to the lobbies of their schools so that anyone who wasn't able to attend Friends and Family will have an opportunity to see a little bit more about what the modulars will look like and where they're going. So that's the first part of the update. The second part is we are still navigating the permit process. We hope to have that complete this week and start pouring foundations either late this week or early next week. We'll have a revised schedule for completion, hopefully tomorrow. I think they're planning on it for our vendor meeting. We have two very big meetings scheduled tomorrow. One is a vendor meeting where RMLD and all the other stakeholders for the utility tie-in and other things that have to happen will be meeting tomorrow. And then we're having a pre-construction meeting with the building principals and our OPM and Vanguard representatives. So the plans that we have now that we'll give to the principals tomorrow actually show where the fence line will be around the construction site. It will be a post-in-ground fence, so it'll be a very secure fence to, you know, keep the children safe and keep the construction secure. What else do I have to say?
When will that go in? Because school's almost out at this point.
Yeah.
We'll still keep the site safe, though.
We'd still want, because there'll be students still playing
in and around
playground and fields and things like that.
So, the modulars are under construction in Pennsylvania. We had a DRT meeting earlier this week with a number of representatives from various department heads on the town side, and we'll be closely coordinating the transport of the units into town. So it's a logistical scheduling to start the process to move them from Pennsylvania to here. The convoy will take a number of days to get here, and then getting them staged and using transferred to smaller vehicles to get them into the Barrows and the Eaton and navigating the construction on West Street. So all the right people met each other earlier in the week, and we'll move forward with that. But they are being built right now in Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
Do you mind if I just ask a question on that one? When you get the updated schedule, can the committee get that before our next meeting?
Mm-hmm.
That would be great. And one more follow-up. At this point, do you see any challenges because there's been this permitting delay for the start of school, or at this point, are we still tracking?
When I spoke with the representatives from Vanguard tonight, they're very hopeful that they will still be ready for the last week of August.
Great.
For opening day.
Thank you.
So. Stay tuned.
Will do.
I have a few.
Sure.
Okay. So I just wanted to update the committee on our current enrollment projections for elementary for next year. I'll wait till this document gets around. And while it's going around, one of the things that I know the committee has held steadfast in terms of guidelines is that we've tried to maintain a 18 to 22 class size in grades K through 2 and mid-20s 3 through 5, or at least mid-20s 3 through 5. I think you could see that our K-2 class sizes for next year are, for the most part, within that range. We have Wood End is two students over in grade two. Grades 3 through 5 are also well within that mid-20 range. Mm-hmm. Certainly the 6 modular classrooms have helped us. Mm-hmm. We're also using the same number of kindergarten teachers next year as we are this year. I think right now, very positive. We do see a lot of for sale signs in Reading, which will mean turnover of homes, which usually means families move into those homes with younger children. So this will be an ongoing process for the rest of the summer. We are continuing to get phone calls daily from people that are moving in. So we will, every time we meet, we will keep you updated if there's major changes that are occurring. But we wanted to make you aware, because we have heard at the forums some concerns about class sizes. I think you can see these are the class sizes that we have right now. We check with the buildings on a regular basis. And they need to contact us when they're moving in. And if they contact the buildings, they're told they need to contact us, and that's when we determine what school they will be attending. Any questions on that?
Yes.
I guess I just want to make a comment that I think, given the cuts and decisions that we had to make this year, this is really outstanding. And not that the community, I don't think, not the community doesn't appreciate it. I think they do appreciate it. I think the thing is they only really, really appreciate it when it's not this way.
Right.
And so, again, challenges. I think we've done an outstanding job. Obviously, there's concerns with the families moving in, but the challenge with this for next year is going to be even more considerable. So thank you for all the work that you've done in terms of sort of figuring that all out and allocating teachers in the right places. And
do we have a sense, I mean, maybe we don't, but do we get a sense for where the houses, I mean, I'm looking at the Wood End second mm-hmm. grade,
mm-hmm.
and a couple more kids is gonna,
yep.
So do we know where those, yeah.
There are homes all over Reading there.
So what will we, well, never mind. Yeah. Yes.
Have you needed to exercise any superintendent options yet to get these numbers?
We probably do it about 20% of the time right now. But it's really those neighborhoods that could go to either school. Mm-hmm. They're on the border, and they've been assigned to one school district, but they could easily go to the other. So we've had that a few times happen this year. Yes.
Thank you. Have you started thinking through which of the kindergartens we use the integrated model and which won't? I'm just trying to do some quick math
yep.
on my paper.
No, the integrated models will be at Eaton and Wood End. The other three will be the regular split. This will also be the first time that we will be able to have all of our half-day kindergartens in the morning, and they will not have to flip mid-year. Which is, I think, great for parents. It's also great for students because they will get a larger amount of instructional time because they will not lose the Wednesday when they go to the afternoon piece.
Did you get any discussion on the integrated model at the forums at all? Or any?
We had a couple bring up the concerns with the integrated model, yes. Yes.
Just a quick follow-up. At Killam, how many classes, that's the only one I haven't gotten to the math, is that 4?
3.5.
So, the 56,
so you've got a half day of 19, and
the
you've
56
got
will be divided into
three full day.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes. So, John, with Killam, is that a function of space? Because at 19 half day, I mean, that could be its own class, almost.
That is its own class.
It is.
Oh, I'm sorry, it is. Oh, so it's just Wood End and
Wood End and Eaton are the two integrated schools
so
for next
few.
Year.
Okay. Oh, no, actually, I'm sorry. Then I meant to ask that question about Wood End. That's where I had checked off.
We were restricted 18. By staffing.
Okay.
We have, I think it's 14 and a half kindergarten teachers. If we went and split the Wood End kindergarten or any of the other ones, we would have to add more staffing.
Okay.
Woodend has done integrated in the past.
Thank you. Did you have other?
I do. Would like to pass out this letter that is from Dr. Andrew Friedman, who is the chair of the Reading Board of Health. I'll give you a second to get it. I know Dr. Friedman contacted a couple of the school committee members as well. And the whole purpose of the letter is really to make us aware of some of the research that is out there behind having school start later for adolescents, predominantly middle school and high school. And the American Association of Pediatrics came out with a research paper a couple years ago around this issue. We've had a lot of internal discussions around this very item of having our high school and middle school students start school later and finishing later. I would consider this a part of the conversation that we're having about other areas in our schools that have come up at a couple of the forums. And so, you know, this will be something that in September we will be drilling down deeper on to get more feedback from the community on. There are some logistical issues involved with doing this. Not as much in Reading because we don't have the busing that other districts have. So busing is certainly sometimes an obstacle to making this happen. Another one is athletics, because at the high school the athletics do start later, would have to start later in certain seasons. But these are the types of things that would happen during these conversations. It certainly is, the research is very clear, it is certainly better for students. Having two adolescent daughters myself, I know that they tend to function better when they get up later. And I think that's the case in in a lot of homes. So it is something that you know, I met with Dr. Friedman this evening and told him that, you know, this is something that certainly we will be discussing more in the future. And he said that he would be more than happy to come and talk to the committee in the future if needs the need be. So I wanted to share that with you.
Thank you.
Just a quick comment. Yeah. So I just noticed the recommendations that they made, as you know, I probably made comment on one of them, in exempting student athletes from physical education requirements. One, that would be a vote by the school committee. Two, there's two separate entities, athletics and physical education, do not serve the same purpose. Secondly, there's also a big question as to whether or not you can actually do that, because students are required to have a free education. I forget the whole term now. What's the term there?
Oh, free.
Free and appropriate education.
Free and appropriate education, whereas we charge for athletics, that wouldn't be free. So those are some considerations that have to be made. I would be vehemently opposed to it, by the way, in case you wouldn't guess that.
I believe Dr. Friedman was just citing the report and some of the suggestions.
Well, he mentioned
I don't believe he was advocating for any of the points that were
listed
there.
Good to know.
There.
But I just wanted to, since it was there, I wanted to advocate in my direction as well.
Thank you.
I have more.
Yes.
Sorry.
No, I know.
I did send this to the committee electronically, and our state legislators also have received this, but I did want to publicly bring it up as well. And I didn't want to take time during the session with them because I know that you had questions for them. So my association recently came out with a position paper on what they would consider the next generation of student assessments in Massachusetts. And I think it's important that in the discussion that's going on about assessment, the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents is not taking a position of PARC versus MCAS, because that really isn't the question here. The question, I think, you know, that we need to be discussing is what should good assessment look like, how it should be administered, the frequency it should be administered, the purpose of assessment, the timely feedback that you get from assessment, and the quality and making sure that it's valid, reliable, fair, free from bias. Those are all important points when we're considering what type of assessment we want to see for our students. So this position paper goes into a lot of detail about the type of assessments we feel as superintendents are important for our students for the next generation. Again, it's we're not taking a position on whether it be PARC or MCAS or MCAS 2.0, but I think it's important that we go back to the conversation of what should good assessments look like, what are we doing with the feedback to improve instruction, which improves student learning. So I did send that to you electronically, but I wanted to give it to you in paper as well. And I know that at the hearing, it was given out at the hearing last week as a major position paper. So I just wanted to share that with the committee.
John, can I just ask one question? Early when you were talking about PARC and you said, I know next year we're going from one session, you know, from 2 to 1. Mm-hmm. And you said it was a total of 90 minutes less?
For a student would be taking 90 minutes less of a test, correct,
okay.
Of testing.
But that's based on going from 2 to 1. So now, the one is increased in time.
No. The total amount of testing
right.
would decrease by 90 minutes.
I'm not asking it properly. So, but within the one session, is it a longer session?
No.
It's not?
No, this is assuming the same
okay.
sessions. The downside to doing that, and they've been getting feedback from all the states, the consortium, the downside to doing that is when you collapse the two testing sessions, you had your written one in March, and your so it allowed more time for the scoring. So now the scoring is going to be done later, which means you're going to get your feedback later. That's the downside of going from 2 to 1. Because now you're probably your testing time frame would be in the April time frame instead of the March and May, which it is now. Okay. So
so it doesn't really provide you much time to make the type of adjustments in your curriculum or
that's what we're being school. That's what we're being told, yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean that, you know, we've got a long way to go before we go to that. We don't know what's gonna happen next year, but
so I guess I'm being picky, but if the association's not take, why are they calling it the PARC position report?
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, that's...
In the right hand, it's just like the name of
the file.
On the
top right hand of every page. Not that page, flip it, next.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, we are not taking
well,
a position on PARC.
That's not how it presents
but
itself.
If you read it, it says specifically we are not taking a position on PARC versus MCAS.
I sort of agree. They should probably just relabel, take that header
right.
off or relabel
yeah.
this. And
no, it's a good point.
I think, yeah.
But when you read the actual
yeah.
details of the position paper, it's very clear we're not taking
also,
position.
That's what the board is going to, that's their vote, I think, about PARC.
Right. The board's vote is going to be about PARC, which is why I think they put PARC position paper. It's a position paper on the vote that the board is going to take.
Yes.
Thank you. I had a question about the last bullet point on page 6. And I know you didn't personally write this, so it's just your perspective on it. The very last bullet point on page 6 is during the initial, this is a recommendation from the MASS. During the initial years of implementation, the proposed assessment results will not be used to calculate the accountability rating, rather, it should be regarded as pilot results. Did you have any sense from how, or any conversations about what the initial, like 1 year, 3 years, five, like is, do you have any sense of?
No, there wasn't a time frame. I think it came down to, I think it was being discussed here tonight with the state legislators, that it really comes down to when the test would be ready. So you would have a phase-in period.
Okay. So,
that I think that's what everyone is referring to. What is that time period? Is it 1 year? Is it 2 years? Is it 3 years?
And would the idea be, because this is a little bit vague, so I'm trying to wrap my head around what the specific recommendation is. The idea would be, okay, we're going to try this new assessment tool, so we're going to take a period of time and only use this assessment tool. But for this period of time, we won't publish results and we won't do anything with them until we're sure the assessment tool is good.
Until it's valid and reliable.
Until it's valid and
yes.
reliable. Okay.
How long? That can take long time.
This is a position paper. They, you know, that's why they specifically don't talk about the amount of time.
Yeah, and I just editorial comment. I'm concerned about that. I read this. I agree with 98.5% of it. I think it's really, really thoughtful and really thorough and really good. That bullet gave me pause. I certainly would want that to be fleshed out a little bit more. You know, since the adoption of MCAS in 1993, we've seen tremendous success in Massachusetts, and anything that would put the brakes on that for a long period of time would make me nervous. But the rest of it, I think, is just fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This question, so, I mean, I don't think we want to continue this discussion tonight, but I do think that, you know, maybe this is a topic area that we need to put together something to give the legislators on, you know, what's our position, what's important to us. I think in general, we might need to be a little bit more cognizant of, you know, important issues at the State House that we need to make sure that the legislators do understand, you know, what we want them to do, how we do that, whether we do position papers or other methods of communication. But we just may want to, you know, consider maybe with our our work with MASC, the being district, a better school committee,
yeah, district governance.
Yeah, well, district governance. You know, that might be something we have an opportunity to talk a little bit more about through that process.
Thank you. Do you have more?
The only other thing I had is, and I did send this out to the committee, is Thursday afternoon at 2:30. There's going to be a retirement reception for Mike Scarpito. I know that the committee was interested in knowing when that was. So, and it's going to be in the Scatini Library Media Center.
What time again was that? I think you sent it.
2:30.
Not out by the bell.
No. I'm sure the bell will get rung.
Wrong, yeah.
Field trips.
Absolutely. Mr. Chair, move to approve the RMHS field trip to the Balkan nations of Romania and Bulgaria in June, July 2017.
Second.
If I can just talk globally about all the field trips. So I have met with all of the Parker teachers and Dr. Ryan about all of the field trips that are being presented. Some of the field trips you see are being put in front of you for approval a couple years in advance, and the purpose for that is to allow students to be able to plan accordingly, raise funds for the trip to save money. So that's part of the reason why you see in some cases a two-year approval versus a one-year.
I know I've probably asked this before, but do other teachers ever get an opportunity, or do they don't want to go on these trips? Because it's always Dr. Ryan.
Well, you approved one last week for, or 2 weeks ago for London.
Mr. Dentremont.
Yes.
Which was Gary Dentremont. Okay. You also have your Spanish and French exchange trips, which are done by the Foreign Language Department, which you've approved in the past as well.
Yes.
Question. On this particular field trip, I'm glad you mentioned fundraising, because on the form it says there won't be fundraising. And I actually had a question about that, because it's a very expensive
trip.
To
raise the money.
Did I miss it?
No, I think I understand that's for the students to raise.
No, for
them.
The students to raise their,
yes,
their
the
own.
Students.
Not to have a fundraiser.
Yeah.
The students to raise their.
Right.
So for the students to save on an individual basis.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
If I misspoke, I apologize.
Cut the grass. Got it.
Yeah. Cut the grass, do their chores, right, mow the lawn, shovel snow.
Got
we got 2 years of that.
Got it.
Yeah.
That's carrots. Excuse me. But the students aren't going out and soliciting funds on their own. They're not asking. Yeah, so
no.
So they all do say no.
Just
fundraising. Okay, all right, just to plan. Okay, for saving.
Yes, I just want to make a comment. You know, I have the utmost faith in Dr. Jeff Ryan and Gary Dentremont. I meant to mention it last week too, but I am really. I just want to emphasize the importance, which I'm sure Dr. Daugherty has done, but I just want to do it publicly as well, of the importance of really tight oversight on these trips. There's been incidents in other surrounding communities that can make a school district look really bad, plus, you know, who knows what kind of problems can occur. I've actually supervised students on overnight trips for a week as a coach, and I would never do it again personally. I admire the fact that they're willing to do it. I think it's a great educational opportunity, but I just want to emphasize that, you know, just really tight oversight is really important.
I did speak to all of the chaperones about that very issue.
So I just wanted to throw it out there myself, too.
Dr. Daugherty, on these the trips overseas, do parents, can they also chaperone, or is it just staff?
It's usually just staff.
Okay. Ms. Webb.
I just want to add, I understand Mr. Nyan's caution and your tenacity to look at these trips very closely. But I just also want to emphasize, as you go out, I have three in college now, another one in another year with Chuck. And when you go on the college tours and you look at what the colleges are presenting, but when you look at what they're looking for in students, they are looking for students that have a global perspective, that have experience with other cultures. And I do think that it's important that we continue to offer that. And some of the middle school trips that are on here today, you know, are small, shorter trips. Frankly, even they went to New York. Somebody went to New York City. You know, some kids might never get from Boston to New York. And it's great that we offer that. Now, I think you can get a lot of culture in New York, but I just, especially when you're looking at the colleges and you're looking at what they're expecting, and I think as a college student today, you'd have to be almost hard-pressed to graduate college without having some kind of international experience. So the students that have that background from high school, I think, are giving themselves a great leverage and also leveraging their own ability to then take advantage of that, of what the colleges offer. So I think it's a great thing that we do. I think we have to continue to make sure that we really look at it all very closely, and I think we are doing that. But I
just want to reemphasize, I'm not saying we shouldn't do that, Elaine. I'm just saying we need to keep tight oversight. There's been incidents in other communities. I can think of one a couple years ago that was really bad in one of the W school districts down south that I don't think we'd want to have tagged to our school district. So fine, I think it's great. They should go. But needs to be tight oversight.
Yes.
I think that it's a collaboration, too, and that working together, the chaperones, the teachers, and the parents, sending a strong message to the students about what the expectations are. And reading through the material, the expectations are very clear in here about the rules of the country and the rules of the trip. And if the rules of the trip are different than the rules of the country, then you go by the rules of the trip. And so I think the parents, we, and the teachers are working hopefully together to impress upon the students that it's not an opportunity if the drinking age is 18 in another country, it's not an opportunity to go out drinking, that the expectations of the trip are clear, and that it's all of us working together, not just on the teachers who are there, who also have to get some sleep at night. So as a team, I think we can help to keep our kids safe.
I would agree, but I do think it's something that warrants tight oversight, is all I'm saying. And maybe not everybody does get to sleep at night, to be perfectly honest.
That's the longest debate we've ever had on a field trip.
It was a global comment.
About all of them. Now we can do.
Is there a vote on the motion?
Ready?
Yep. You already read the motion.
Yeah, you're right.
Are we doing all of them at the same time?
Oh, no, we're just doing
one.
The one.
That's
right. Just yeah. Romania and Bulgaria.
Just Romania. Yeah. Okay.
I mean,
yeah.
All right.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the annual RMHS field trip to the Metropolitan Opera in New York City in March 2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Yes.
I love that these opportunities are given to our kids, and that the teachers, kudos to the teachers who are willing to take that time out of their schedule and who really enjoy, it just shows how much they enjoy the students in this time together. I think it's a great opportunity.
Thank you. All those in favor? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the annual Parker 8th grade field trip to Quebec, Canada in April 2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those. 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the annual Parker 8th grade field trip to Washington, D.C. in October 2015.
Is there a second?
Second.
If I can just give one comment
yes.
on this. For those of you that may notice, this trip is actually in the fall this year. It's been in the spring in the past. Mr. Lyons said the reason for that is that it's a better team building experience for the 8th grade by having it in the fall. It also coincides with the next field trip that you're going to be approving, which is the 7th grade field trip. So there'll be about a grade and a half of the school will be out of the building during this 3 days.
Question on
yes.
this one. On the paperwork for the Washington, D.C. trip, it said approximately one half of the 8th grade students attended. That struck me as kind of low. Is that typical?
No, Parker, that's actually a good number.
Okay.
And there was a waiting list last year. So they're going to try to see if they can get more another bus so that the waiting list doesn't, you know, that they can fill the waiting list.
Okay.
But a typical graduating 8th grade class is 200 students, so it's 100 students.
Okay. And would you say, so the main reason half the class isn't going, is that more that there just isn't capacity, or is that more that there just isn't interest?
I think maybe a little bit of both.
Okay.
The students that stay behind, they'll be from two different teams, but they'll be mixed.
Okay.
And they'll be doing their own activities. Like, they'll be going on field trips more local.
Okay.
Into Boston.
Yeah, I think my concern, I'm certainly going to approve it. I respect the principal's discretion on it. But I do have a concern about a field trip that takes half the class and they get one experience and half the class gets another. That's just something to keep an eye on in the future.
That, just so you're aware, that has happened for several years.
Okay, thank you.
At both schools, both middle schools, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Excuse me, is it possible
yes.
that it's cost prohibitive for
it,
some people?
It could be.
It
could be.
Yeah.
It is an airline ticket.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
All those in favor? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the annual Parker 7th grade field trip to Nature's Classroom in October 2015.
Second. This is the plan going forward is to keep these two trips in the fall now as opposed to the spring?
I'm not sure if this is a permanent switch or
how it works.
I do know this is why he moved the 8th grade.
I think it sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the annual Parker 8th grade trip to Costa Rica in April 2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
If I can just, the kids that go on this trip are the students that have been involved in the Eco Club for the entire year leading up to this trip. Actually, in some cases, for 2 years.
When is this trip, though, the date? Sorry.
It's April vacation.
April vacation.
There's a parent information
okay.
meeting on it
this
Wednesday.
Letter is, okay.
Right,
so
assuming that it gets approved tonight.
Yes.
It was pending approval.
Did you have
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I just was giving information on the information meeting.
Okay.
So February vacation?
It's April vacation.
All those in favor of the motion? 6-0. Now we have some donations to approve.
Sounds good. Move to accept two donations totaling $11,642.87 from the Killam PTO to be used to improve the technology at the school.
Is there a second?
Yes, second.
Wow.
Did they have an auction or something? That's a lot of donations.
I don't think they had an auction.
I haven't heard it. Maybe they had some.
Very
incredible
nice donation. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to accept the donation of native trees to our schools from Mahoney's Rocky Ledge of Winchester.
there a second?
Second.
I could just
yes.
You may have noticed these at the schools. I believe 6 of our 8 schools have these trees. The Reading Garden Club worked with Mahoney's of Winchester to plant these trees at different spots in at each of the schools. So you'll notice it has a green sign with yellow lettering in front of the tree. So I believe they're all native species is what we were told, correct? Mm-hmm. So that it will attract butterflies and other fauna for in the area. So, you know, thanks to the Reading Garden Club for initiating this.
So it's both Mahoney's and the Garden Club, really?
The Garden Club facilitated the donation.
Oh, Mahoney's made the donation.
With the schools.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed? None. 6-0.
Move to accept a donation of $346.25 from the Wood End PTO to be used to purchase agenda books for the 4th and 5th grade students.
Is there a second?
A second.
Any discussion? We usually have discussion on that. All those in favor?
Agenda books.
6-0.
Move to accept a donation of equipment with an approximate value of $6,550 from Teradyne to be used to enhance the science program at Parker Middle School.
Was there a second?
Second. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Just also, Teradyne also makes a major monetary contribution to our robotics team each year, our high school robotics team.
Right.
Waddell.
All those in favor? Opposed? None. 6-0.
Move to accept a donation in the amount of $1,350 from PSST to be used to support the improv instructor for the second semester.
Is there a second?
I have a footnote on this one also. You approved a donation, I believe, last time or a couple times ago. It was for the wrong amount, but the check was larger. So this is the difference in the check. It didn't include the improv instructor. So now it clarifies the donation from PSST.
All those in favor? 6-0. Yes.
A general comment. How fortunate we are to have the PTOs that are working together to fund these things that our budget don't allow, and these other outside companies that are also helping to make things happen for our kids. Thank you to everyone that's doing that.
Thank you. Yes.
I just want to add, and thank you, the donation from Teradyne, obviously there's a parent employee. It can be extremely challenging to get these kinds of donations, so I just really appreciate the fact that probably this parent had to work through a lot of legal and paperwork and everything to get these. Just being for myself, I haven't been able to get through those challenges where I work to donate equipment. So I really appreciate that, not only the company's willingness, but the person who fought the battle to get the donation made. Because lots of times companies will just throw this stuff out. They're done with it. They'll throw it out. It's out of service. They don't use it. But schools could use this equipment. And I feel terribly that I know what's going in our dumpsters, and we just can't quite get through the process.
No dumpster diving?
Yeah, so.
You don't do any dumpster diving?
Yeah, we used to do dumpster diving. The company got in a lot of trouble.
Really?
Yeah. So.
Thank you.
Anyway, thank you.
Move to approve the open session minutes dated June 1st, 2015.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any comments? None. All those in favor? 6-0. Is there any other business?
Did you want to talk about next Monday?
Oh, the
district governance. Did you want?
Yeah, sure.
So we had a conference call with.
Oh, I'm sorry. That. Oh,
that. Yes. Did you want to talk about the conference?
Oh, go ahead.
We had a conference call with Dorothy Presser to just kind of give her the. She had questions about the committee and, you know, the the members of the committee and how many years they'd been on the committee, things like that, so she could get an understanding of the group. So the first session is going to be basically going over rules, protocols, things like that, but it sounds like she's tailoring it to the needs of the of our school committee.
Yeah, we had a probably what a 45-minute call with Jean, and it was good. It was productive, I thought. So.
Great, thank you both for putting in all that time. All you, John, but appreciate it.
Yeah.
Do we have a start time?
Seven.
Seven. Usual meeting time.
Okay.
It's a two-hour workshop, is that what's that?
Yeah, she said. Yep.
Yeah, she she was very well. I thought well prepared, and the conversation was a very good back and forth in terms. And she, you know, she heard what we were looking for, and I think she'll come here.
Great.
Prepared. Good solid. Do some work. And we talked about the setting might not, it will probably be more like a
retreat.
Where we have the tables kind of in a circle or something.
Great.
Good.
Any other business? Yes.
Nope. Just gonna
is there
make
a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Seconded.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.